you'd find everything with glow will glow with the light of Tawheed. Given that why were we created? We were created so that we make our actions qualitatively well. The first reason was so that we are completely submissive to Allah, completely obedient to Allah. The second reason mentioned is that we have qualitative action. The third reason, or that in a third verse, we are told that the reason of creation is so that you get knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِتَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. So that you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is powerful over everything. وَأَنَّهُ أَحَاطَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا. And that he has knowledge, he encompasses everything in knowledge. So the purpose of creation is so that you can get ma'rifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the third reason mentioned. Like that, we have several reasons. Another reason, for example, mentioned is that the purpose of creation is so that you become close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And closeness, obviously, doesn't mean a kind of distance, which is physical distance, all of you know. The reality of closeness is that when a person embellishes himself with the attributes of Allah, the way he is kind, he makes himself kind. The way he is powerful, he also tries to become powerful in the right means. The way he is open-handed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is open-handed, he also makes himself open-handed. He tries to embellish himself with the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And slowly and gradually he becomes close to Allah. Now, these are some of the things that have been mentioned in the Holy Quran and in our riwayat. One of the very beautiful riwayat that has been mentioned is from Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. In which the Imam says that Allah did not create the creation. Ma khalaq Allah illa liya'buduhu, except that they should be submissive to him, or that they should worship him. Let me correct myself. Illa liya'rifuhu, except that they should know him. Fa'idha 'arafuhu 'abaduhu. When they know him is when they will be submissive to him. When they know him is when they will naturally do ibadat. You've seen sometimes when a person doesn't know somebody and he is forcefully told to do something, he would not do it the way it should be done. Why? Because he doesn't know him. But when he knows him, naturally that veneration comes. A very good example for us within the human beings, we find that we have great ulama like Ayatollah Sistani, Ayatollah Khamenei and others. Now we have heard about them and we have known about them, but we have not seen them. When we go near them, we don't talk to them casually as if we know them for a long time. No, the way we sit down before them, the way we ask permission, everything changes. There is that awe and veneration that is created. Why? Because we have knowledge. So illa liya'rifuhu, Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam says Allah did not create the creation except that for knowledge of him. Fa'idha 'arafuhu 'abaduhu. When they know him is when they would naturally worship him. See, there are some people, some of the great ulama, we are told, like a very good example is that of Ayatollah Behjat. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevate his station. During his time, you find that this man was constantly worshipping. And he was steadfast in worshipping. In the morning, after Salatul Subh, he would go to Haram every day in the morning. Now, this is not a joke. You know, people may say that, okay, because we are in this holy city of Qum, we will go every day in morning to the Haram, and we would really do the ziyarat of Hazrat Ma'asuma alayhi salam. But this tawfiq is not given to all. This needs a person who is aware And this awareness actually is not conceptual. It's not of the mind. Because conceptual awareness, you tend to forget. Conceptual awareness, you tend to even lose it from your mind. Conceptual awareness does not give you the full picture of the reality. But the presential awareness, the awareness of the heart, shows you the reality. It is narrated from Ayatollah Behjat. One of the ulama narrated this, that once we were in the haram, it was morning prayer. After morning prayers, Ayatollah Behjat came and suddenly he said, please move out from here because there are so many angels surrounding. And the people near Ayatollah Behjat saw nothing around. But Ayatollah Behjat was looking at the intermediate realm, and that is the realm of Barzakh, and he could decipher that the angels are there. You know, when we are told that in Laylatul Qadr, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَ. Now, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَ in Arabic, الْمَلَائِكَ means all of the malaika, because Alif and Lam has come in a plural. When Alif and Lam comes in the plural, it means all are shamil. تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَ وَالْرُوحُ فِيهَا. But do we see them? We don't see them. Because we don't have that inner perception. We have conceptual knowledge because the Holy Quran is said, and we know that the Holy Quran has been proven miraculously, so that it is a miracle. We have established it. Because of that, we say, yes, whatever Allah says is correct. We believe, although we cannot see. This is conceptual knowledge. And of course, if you go higher, conceptual knowledge is when you have a dalil, intellectual proof of that. That is also conceptual knowledge. Because it's everything is in the mind. But sometimes there is inkishaf. You can see the realities. And that is the kind of knowledge that Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam is referring to. Illa liya'arifuhu. فَإِذَا عَرَفُوهُ عَبَدُوهُ. If they really know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would really worship Him. And you would really see, as it has been narrated about our A'imma alayhimu salam, that just by when they were doing wudu, they would shake in fear. The color of their faces would change. Why? Because that there is presential knowledge. If you go and see some of the ulama explain this reality, that the whole wudu that we are doing are the stations of akhir. Because you know, when you say Allahumma bayyid wajhi yawma taswaddu fihi alwujuh, you're talking about akhir. Oh Allah, brighten my face the day when faces will be dark. Allahumma a'tini kitabi biyamini wal khulda fil jinani biyasari wa hasibni hisaban yasira. Oh Allah, give me my book on my right hand on the day of judgment. But day of judgment, of obviously, we must understand, it is not something which is parallel to this world. It is longitudinally interconnected. Now, for the youngsters, when I say longitudinally interconnected, it means that this reality has different levels. The higher level has a very high perfect form. As you go down, it is diluted. And as you come down, this is the lowest of the low. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. We have created the human being in the best of forms, in the highest levels. ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ. Then we took him to the lowest of the low, and that is the earth. This earth that we are living in. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, but your journey is again towards that same place. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Except those who believe and have balanced action. For them, they would continue and go to the heights of perfection. And this is what I would like to mention now. The story that we are going to mention in our lectures, inshallah, in future would be this. That now that we know the purpose of creation, how to get to that purpose, how to get to the proximity of Allah, how to get this ma'rifah that we talked about, this presential knowledge, how to make our a'mal qualitative, How to do all these things, all these purposes which merge into one important purpose, and that is the proximity and the closeness of Allah. How to achieve that? What is the strategy? And the strategy has been mentioned in this same verse that I quoted, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. You know, we have heard about Iman and Amalun Salih so many times. And it has been going into our minds now and again, and we just take the meaning superficially. But inshallah, we will look at these two important realities in depth, and we will come to realize that the problems of our community, not only this community, every community, is that because we have deficiency in one of these two. And in fact, if you have deficiency and fault in the first important element, and that is Iman, then even that Amalun Salih is not Amalun Salih, because it depends on Iman. So Iman is the very important factor. Now, what we are going to discuss in these nights is that what are the factors that weaken our Iman in the society, and what is the remedy of these weaknesses that come about. For example, I'll just quickly mention some of these maladies that come in us and weaken our Iman. One is ignorance. Because we have just followed what our fathers have said, I don't say what we are following is wrong. It's right, because we have proofs and our ulama have proofs. But so we say that no problem, even if our ulama have proofs, we don't need it, because we can ask them whenever we want to ask. No, because in this life, you will have to face the problems yourself. And there are very many places where you are tried as far as your Iman is concerned. For example, in the university. In the university, there are so many ideologies that are propounded. And when a person enters the university, he feels that now I'm doing BA, now I'm doing MA, and now I'm doing PhD. That arrogance, taints of arrogance sometimes come. Not all are humble people. And they think, yes, this theory or this ideology is correct, and what Islam is telling us is incorrect, for example. So it is better for us to be established in the right roots of religion. We should know it. We should have that Iman, which is qawi, through knowledge. And alhamdulillah, inshallah, we will talk about how to seek that knowledge. We will also give examples of how people have gone astray. And khasirat dunya wal akhirah, dhalika khusranul mubin. This is one of the factors that weaken. Another factor, for example, is, recite a salawat, please. Another factor which slowly creeps in us, because this is a strategy of shaitan, that is the waswasa of shaitan. Shaitan comes first in our ibadat. And you know, you find sometimes a person doing wudu for 20 minutes or half an hour, and still he's not yet, you know, he doesn't have yaqeen that this wudu that I've done is correct. Or sometimes you find that he's just trying to pronounce waladda, waladda, waladza. He's told, recite how you can, no problem. Don't think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will castigate you and tell you, you know, you did not recite waladda lean properly. No, don't go into these things. Shaitan loves that you are stationed over there and you continue and you continue. Now what happens, you find that I have instances, inshallah, I will mention some of these instances of how a person goes and does ghusl and he comes out after 2 hours. And then when I ask him that, now you have done your ghusl, but still I'm not sure whether I have done my ghusl properly or not. Shaitan creeps in like that. The Holy Quran mentions shaitan's strategy as khutuwat is shaitan. What is khutuwat? Khutuwat is the plural of khutwa. Khutwa means steps. He doesn't come, he doesn't attack just like that. He goes step by step, step by step. He first comes in this ibadat. You find that a person cannot even do his hajj. I remember in one of our hajj sessions, or when I had gone to hajj in one of the years, A person came and he said, you know, I have doubt about this, but I've done. But I am just doubtful. I said, there is no need of doing it now. But he was completely uneasy till he did it again. Now, this is something which is very bad. You'll find Shaitan coming in the ibadat first. Once he now knows that this person is really having problems in ibadat, he starts doing another waswasa. That is this Islam? That you have to do ghusl and wuzu and you what taharat and all these things. What religion are you following? Look at the Christians and look at the other creeds. They are better off. They are smiling every day. You are, look at your face. It's, you know, you are always sad and always not sure of what you are doing. Leave this religion. But if a person is astute enough, he says, no, the problem is with me. Shaitan is disturbing me. But Shaitan doesn't stop over there. Then he goes into the aqaid and says, but you know, who says God is there? You have so many problems. You don't have money. Your wife is disturbing you. You have different social problems. You are ostracized from the community. And so on. And look at that person. He is rich. He is this. You think there is God? Because if there was God, he was just. He would give everybody the same. Now this is how he creeps in some things which are very surprising. I remember in one of my encounters with a youth, he asked me some questions which obviously would come in a person's mind if he has gone through those kutuwat of shaitan. So this is the second factor, and inshallah we will cover it in different phases. It's very interesting, and we will also tell you what is the remedy of this second factor of weakening the faith of religion, which is so if a person doesn't have faith, then he doesn't go to the elevated status, he doesn't go to the proximity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third reason for weakness of faith is when a person continues to sin. And he thinks these are light sins. It's only ghibat, isn't it? I'm not doing zina. I'm not doing qatl. These are small sins, no problem. No. Bibi Zainab salamullah alayha. When addressing Yazid, mentions a very important verse. ثم كان عاقبة الذين أساءوا السوء أن كذبوا بآيات الله. Those people who continue sinning come to a station whereby they say, you know, interest is something good. If a fool is a person who doesn't take interest, he make that bad deed which is harb ma'allah. The Quran is there. The Quran is explicitly saying that, you know, you clearly announce that you are fighting against Allah if you are taking interest, the haram interest, obviously. So this is harb, but the person thinks it's good. He says, in fact, you are crazy if you don't take interest. And I have witnessed this, that there are some people, like I remember in one of the gatherings, the person says, you think interest is wrong, but I believe that interest is good. And he's a Shia. So slowly and gradually what happens is the person makes these things feel, you know, he continues. A time comes when he says that these things are good for me, and he loses his iman. When he loses his iman, it becomes like Yazid and Muawiyah and Umar ibn Sa'ad and so on. You know, Umar ibn Sa'ad, his history, many of you may have heard from the Mawlanas who have told you, but one of the laqab of Umar ibn Sa'ad was the pigeon of the mosque, Hamamatul Masjid. Because he would frequently do ibadat, he would frequently go to the mosque. And this same person comes and fights against Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. So it is very important for us to even look at this factor, and that is sinning. We don't take this thing lightly. This also has the mechanics, spiritual mechanics that we are going to talk about, that how a person slowly and gradually from sinning, he loses his faith. Another very important factor that we will talk about in detail is haram food and how haram food slowly and gradually makes a person lose his iman. So these are some of the factors that we are going to talk about throughout the Ashr-e Zainabiyya, inshallah. And we will try to look at the remedies also, because some people have already been entangled. I'll tell you one of the maladies, some of our brothers, I don't know about this community, but in some other communities, when I talked about this, they said this, that we are already entangled in this. Now tell me how to come out. In fact, the taxi driver who was taking me to the airport from Qom to Tehran, when I talked about this to him, he said, actually, tell me the easiest form of ghusl, because still it's disturbing me. Alhamdulillah, he had not gone to that extreme. Because when a person goes to the extreme, I know of a lady who was writing to me and telling me, please show me something that I come out from this problem, because whenever I go to the toilet, it takes me about 20, 30 minutes and sometimes more than that, just to relieve myself and wash myself. And actually, some of these factors are because of the ignorance, because you see, when you are washing yourself, your private parts, and the water that comes out and goes through that najasat, that is known as ghusala. And if this water comes out, that is not najis, unless there are deposits of najasat there, and you cannot try to take a magnifying glass and see, are there deposits or not? For you, it is pak. Not that when it goes from one place, you start cleaning here, and then you start cleaning there, and then you start cleaning there, and then it continues, and then the person who is the owner of the house says, what has happened? No, I'm washing your toilet. This is actually, you know, it's not a simple thing. I remember I visited Ayatollah Bashir Najafi. There was a professional accountant who had come. He said, I'm suffering from this. Please tell me, what is the remedy? And Ayatollah Bashir Najafi told him the remedy. I'll tell you afterwards, inshallah. The remedy is not just one sentence. The remedy is a whole strategy, inshallah. Recite a salawat, please. And one of the most important, or one of the most effective things that actually breaks the iman, is the love of the world. But love of the world is not is different from having the world. You may be having a decent car, you may be having a decent house, you may be having the amenities of life and a decent business as well. Doesn't mean that you are loving the world. Loving the world is when you are attached such that if that is not with you, it becomes so difficult. And it makes a person get heart attack and so on. It makes a person sick and so on when he loses his property. And we have incidents about this. But you find that the same Nabi Sulaiman, salamullah alayhi, who asks Allah for a mulk, for a kingdom that is matchless and outstanding, the same Nabi Sulaiman, when he comes near the alley of ants, he tells his soldiers, do not trample them. They are the makhlukat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This humility and humbleness is depicted in Nabi Sulaiman salamullah alayhi, despite having all the things, even the air was under his control. He could go from one place to the other. The jinns were doing so many things for him. The buildings that he built, if you go and see, history tells us, were not a simple phenomenon. They needed jinns to build, those strong jinns. And he could control them just by giving them isharat. So he had that mulk, that kingdom, which was so powerful. Yet this same Nabi Sulaiman was so humble that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises him in the Holy Quran. And he gives us examples of how humble he is. So when we talk about the love of the world, we are not talking of a person having the world. No, he may have the world, but you find the same person using it for the right purpose, helping people, and so on. Recite a salawat, please. And I think, obviously, there is more to this, but my time is limited. And I think that this is one of the factors that really made the perpetrators of the heinous massacre of Karbala what they did. Whatever they did was because of the love of the world. How much would they earn? What ja'izah would they get? Can you imagine, as I was reading through the Maqtal today, I came to realize that after the 72 heads were beheaded and taken, there were different tribes over there, and all of them wanted to show Yazid that they have done something. So they started distributing the different heads, and one of the tribes took about 5 heads, some tribes took 13 heads, some tribes took 12 heads, just because of getting the ja'izah from Yazid. And they got presents. They got a lot of presents from Yazid. And you find that this continued until they met what they met. Obviously, we have in history of how the problems that they faced and so on. But this was hubbud dunya that had really penetrated in them, that they even, astaghfirullah, after the martyrdom of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, they didn't leave his body. They took out everything that they had. And this is what is known as Salbul Hussein alayhi salam. The ring that he had, the trousers that he had, the spear that he had, whatever he had, they took it out. But they were not satisfied. They even went after the women at night. And they started removing the earrings and the different things that the women had. They put the khiyam on fire. One of the young women that really comes to mind is Bibi Sakina, salamullah alayha. She, one of the things that the ruwat have mentioned is actually her name was Ruqayya, but she was given the epithet of Sakina. The same Sakina who is buried in Syria today and has a beautiful shrine over there. She was a 3-year-old young girl who was disturbed by these heinous people, these bad people. They came and attacked her. And she had to go through the different atrocities and problems because, you know, the aftermath of the Karbala is something which is actually so difficult to bear that words are beyond expression. Because if you look at the details of how, first of all, Imam Hussein alayhi salam's son, Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam, and 11 other male members who accompanied and who were very young, who were children, with the ladies, how they were taken. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam says at one point that, do you know how they took us? They took us like cattle. They tied a rope on my neck. They tied the rope on Bibi Zainab alayhi salam. They tied the rope on the different children. They would take us, and as we were going, if we would not go fast, they would hit us till we reached Yazid in Sham. And when we reached his court and all those problems transpired and he tried to boast about what he boasted, after that, we were taken to a place which was very old and deteriorated, and it did not have a roof, and it was so hot. It is said sometimes Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam would come out to have fresh air. A person asked Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam that you are sick, why don't you remain inside? He says that, you know, there is no place to cover over here. The sun is scorching and it is hitting on us. And one of those people who really suffered was the young one, Ruqayya, who is known as Sakina, salamullah alayha. Kan al-Hussein alayhi salam yuhibbuha hubban shadida. Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam loved her extremely. Wa kanat tuhibbuhu aydan.
And she also loved Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam also. It came a day which was so difficult to mention. It is said that once it so happened that in one night قامت السيدة رقية فزعة. Suddenly Bibi Ruqayya salamullah alayha woke up frightened من نومها from her sleep وقالت and said أين أبي الحسين where is my father الحسين فإني رأيته الساعة في المنام I saw him in my dream مضطربا شديدا he was not feeling well he had constriction of the heart مضطربا شديدا فلما سمعنا النساء بكينا وبكى معهن سائر الأطفال وارتفع العويل والبكاء When the other women heard this from Bibi Ruqayya سلام الله عليها they also started crying with the children and the noise went so loud that Yazid came to know what is happening he said ما الخبر what is the matter فأخبروه بالواقع They informed what happened to Bibi Ruqayya سلام الله عليها فأمر أن يذهبوا إليها برأس أبيها He ordered that Imam al-Hussein عليه السلام's head should be taken to her and it was taken to her but it was covered مغطى بمنديل It was covered with a handkerchief فوضع بين يديها it was put between her فلما كشف الغطاء رأت الرأس الشريف when this handkerchief was removed she saw the face of the father she saw the head of the father she said يا أبتا من الذي خضبك بدمائك Oh dear father, who is the one who colored your face with your blood? Ya Abata, oh my dear father, man alladhi qat'a waridak? Who is the one who cut your throat and who cut your artery? Ya Abata, man alladhi aytamani ala sighar sinni? Who is the one who made me an orphan in this young age? Ya Abata, ما بقي بعدك نرجوه oh dear father we don't have anybody that we have hope on after you from these people يا أبتا من لليتيمة حتى تكبر who is there for this يتيمة this orphan until she grows ثم إنها وضعت now this is the time when she leaves and her soul departs ثم إنها وضعت فمها على فمه الشريف then she places her lips on the lips of her father وبكت بكاء شديدا and she starts crying loudly and intensely حتى غشي عليها until she falls unconscious فهل فلما حركوها وجدوها قد فارقت روحها الحياة when she was shaken so that she wakes up. They saw that the soul had already departed from her body.
أَلَا لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلِبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ
صلى الله عليك يا أبا عبد الله